Dear brothers and sisters, since the beginning of Lent, we have prepared our hearts. Until now, we have done charitable works and acts of penance. Today, we gather together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of our Lord's Paschal mystery, that is to say, of his passion and resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city of our salvation, following in his footsteps. For that being made by his grace partakers of the cross, we may also have a share in his resurrection and in his life. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, sanctify these branches held by the faithful this morning, that we who follow the Christ in exaltation may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Amen. May Almighty God be in your mind, heart, and lips that you might worthily proclaim his gospel. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus proceeded on his journey up to Jerusalem. As he drew near to Bethpage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples. He said, "Go into the village opposite you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tethered on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. And if anyone should ask you, 'Why are you untying it?' you will answer, 'The master has need of it.' So those who had been sent went off, and they found everything just as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owner said to them, 'Why are you untying this colt?' They answered, 'The master has need of it.' So they brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks over the colt, and helped Jesus to mount. As he rode along, the people were spreading their cloaks on the road. And now, as he was approaching the slope of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of his disciples began to praise God aloud with joy for all the mighty deeds they had seen. They proclaimed, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.' He said in reply, 'I tell you, if they keep silent, the stones will cry out.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Dear brothers and sisters, let us now proceed like the crowds who acclaim Jesus in Jerusalem. May we go forth in peace.
Joyce is going to use it later. Just pull it off to the side. She'll use it later.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who is an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Savior to take flesh and submit to the cross. Graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord has given me a well-trained tongue that I might know how to speak to the weary, a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning, he opens my ears that I may hear, and I have not rebelled. I have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard, my face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help, therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
But you are
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found human in appearance, he humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. May Almighty God be in your heart, mind, and lips, that you might worthily proclaim his gospel. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Lord Jesus Christ, glory and praise and honor to you,
Lord Jesus Christ.
Christ became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name. Glory, praise, and honor to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the hour came, Jesus took his place at table with the apostles. He said to them,
I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I shall not eat it again until there is fulfillment in the kingdom of God.
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and said,
take this and share it among yourselves, for I tell you, from this time on I shall not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes.
Then he took the bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them, saying,
"This is my body, which will be given for you. Do this in memory of me."
And likewise the cup after they had eaten, saying,
"This cup is a new covenant in my blood, which will be shed for you. And yet behold, the hand of the one who is to betray me is with me at this table. For the Son of Man indeed goes as has been determined, but woe to that man by whom he is betrayed."
And they began to debate among themselves who among them would do such a deed. Then an argument broke out among them about which of them should be regarded as the greatest. He said to them,
"The kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those in authority over them are addressed as benefactors. But among you it shall not be so. Rather, let the greatest among you be as the youngest, and the leader as a servant. For who is greater, the one seated at table or the one who serves? Is it not the one seated at table? I am among you as the one who serves. It is you who have stood by me in my trials, and I confer a kingdom on you, just as my Father has conferred one on me, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and you will sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has demanded to sift all of you like wheat, but I have prayed that your own faith may not fail. And once you have turned back, you must strengthen your brothers."
He said to him,
"Lord, I am prepared to go to prison and to die with you."
But he replied,
"I tell you, Peter, before the cock crows this day, you will deny me 3 times that you know me."
He said to them,
"When I send you forth without a money bag or a sack or sandals, were you in need of anything?"
No. They replied and said to them,
"But now one who has a money bag should take it, and likewise a sack. And one who does not have a sword should sell his cloak and buy one. For I tell you that the scripture must be fulfilled in me. Namely, he was counted among the wicked. And indeed, what is written about me is coming to fulfillment."
Then they said, but he replied,
"It is enough."
Then going out, he went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he arrived at the place, he said to them,
"Pray that you may not undergo the test."
After withdrawing about a stone's throw from them and kneeling, he prayed, saying,
"Father, if you are willing, take this cup away from me. Still not my will, but yours be done."
And to strengthen him, an angel from heaven appeared to him. He was in such agony, and he prayed so fervently that his sweat became like drops of blood falling on the ground. When he rose from prayer and returned to his disciples, he found them sleeping from grief. He said to them,
"Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not undergo the test."
While he was still speaking, a crowd approached, and in front was one of the 12, a man named Judas. He went up to Jesus to kiss him. Jesus said to him,
"Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss?"
His disciples realized what was about to happen, and they asked,
"Lord, shall we strike the sword?"
And one of them struck the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear. But Jesus said in reply,
"Stop, no more of this."
Then he touched the servant's ear and healed him. And Jesus said to the chief priests and temple guards and elders who had come from for him,
"Have you come out against me as a robber with swords and clubs? Day after day I was with you in the temple area, and you did not seize me. But this is your hour, the time for the power of darkness."
After arresting him, they led him away and took him into the house of the high priest. Peter was following at a distance. They lit a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat around it, and Peter sat down with them. When a maid saw him seated in the light, she looked intently at him and said, but he denied it, saying,
"Woman, I do not know him."
A short while later, someone else saw him and said, but Peter answered,
"My friend, I am not."
About an hour later, still another insisted, but Peter said,
"My friend, I do not know what you are talking about."
Just as he was saying this, the cock crowed, And the Lord turned and looked at Peter. And Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, "Before the cock crows today, you will deny me three times." He went out and began to weep bitterly. The men who held Jesus in custody were ridiculing and beating him. They blindfolded him and questioned him, saying, and they reviled him and saying many other things against him. When day came, the council of the elders of the people met, both chief priests and scribes, and they brought him before the Sanhedrin. They said, but he replied to them,
"If I tell you, you will not believe. And if I question, you will not respond. But from this time on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God."
They all asked,
"Are you the Son of God?"
He replied to them,
"You say that I am."
Then they said, then the whole assembly of them arose and brought him before Pilate. They brought charges against him, saying, Pilate asked him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
He said to him in reply,
"You say so."
Pilate then addressed the chief priests and the crowds,
"I find this man not guilty."
But they were adamant and said, on hearing this, Pilate asked if the man was a Galilean, and upon learning that he was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was in Jerusalem at that time. Herod was very glad to see Jesus. He had been wanting to see him for a long time, for he had heard about him and had been hoping to see him perform some sign. He questioned him at length, but gave him no answer. The chief priests and scribes, meanwhile, stood by accusing him harshly. Herod and his soldiers treated him contemptuously and mocked him. And after clothing him in resplendent garb, he sent him back to Pilate. Herod and Pilate became friends that very day, and even though they had been enemies formerly. Pilate then summoned the chief priests, the rulers, and the people, and said to them,
"You brought this man to me and accused him of inciting the people to revolt. I have conducted my investigation in your presence and have not found this man guilty of the charges you have brought against him, nor did Herod, for he sent him back to us. So no capital crime has been committed by him. Therefore, I shall have him flogged and then release him."
But altogether they shouted out, now Barabbas had been imprisoned for a rebellion that had taken place in the city and for murder. Again, Pilate addressed them, still wishing to release Jesus, but they continued their shouting. Pilate addressed them a third time.
"What evil has this man done? I find him guilty of no capital crime. Therefore, I shall have him flogged and then release him."
With loud shouts, however, they persisted in calling for his crucifixion, and their voices prevailed. The verdict of Pilate was that their demand should be granted. So he released the man who had been imprisoned for rebellion and murder for whom they asked, and he handed Jesus over to them to deal with as they wished. As they led him away, they took hold of a certain Simon, a Cyrenian, who was coming in from the country. And after laying the cross on him, they made him carry it behind Jesus. A large crowd of people followed Jesus, including many women who mourned and lamented him. Jesus turned to them and said,
"Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep instead for yourselves and for your children. For indeed the days are coming when people will say, 'Blessed are the barren, the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' At that time people will say to the mountains, 'Fall upon us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' If these things are done when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?"
Now two others, both criminals, were led away with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him and the criminals there, one on his right and the other on his left. Then Jesus said,
"Father, forgive them. They do not know what they do."
They divided his garments by casting lots. The people stood by and watched. The rulers, meanwhile, sneered at him and said, even the soldiers jeered at him. As they approached to offer him wine, they called out, above him, there was an inscription that read, this is the King of the Jews. Now one of the criminals hanging there reviled Jesus, saying,
are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us.
The other, however, rebuking him, said in reply,
have you no fear of God? For you are subject to the same condemnation. And indeed, we have been condemned justly, for the sentence we received corresponds to our crimes. But this man has done nothing criminal.
Then he said,
Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.
He replied to him,
amen, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise.
It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m, because of an eclipse of the sun. Then the veil of the temple was torn down the middle. Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
And when he had said this, he breathed his last. The centurion who witnessed what had happened glorified God and said,
this man was innocent beyond doubt.
When all the people who had gathered for this spectacle saw what had happened, they returned home beating their breasts. But all his acquaintances stood at a distance, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, and saw these events. Now there was a virtuous and righteous man named Joseph, who, though he was a member of the council, but had not consented to their plan of action. He came from the Jewish town of Arimathea and was awaiting the kingdom of God. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. After he had taken the body down, he wrapped it in a linen cloth and laid it in a rock-hewn tomb in which no one had yet been buried. It was a day of preparation, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The women who had come from Galilee with him followed behind, and when they had seen the tomb and the way in which his body was laid in it, they returned and prepared spices and perfumed oils. Then they rested on the Sabbath according to the commandment. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. A blessed Palm Sunday to all of you and to your families. We enter now the most sacred week of the church's year, Holy Week. And during this week, we commemorate, as we do today, the Lord's Passion. We commemorate the great gift of the Eucharist on Holy Thursday, Good Friday, the death of the Lord upon the cross for us. And on Holy Saturday, which is the church's most quiet day of the year, we await the Easter Vigil to celebrate the resurrection of the Lord. Palm Sunday gives us the opportunity to receive palm. And palm has a significance, a symbolism to it, and it is a symbolism of peace. As we read in the Gospel of St. Luke this morning, when Jesus comes into Jerusalem, he comes riding on a donkey. It was the custom at the time when a king entered a particular region, he came in one of two ways. One, as seated on a donkey as a sign of peace. The other was upon a horse as a sign of waging war. Jesus, of course, accepts the recognition of him as the king, but as the king of peace. And so palm is spread before him, palm is waved before him, and that palm is a sign of peace. As we receive the palm today, we realize that peace is so much needed in our world today. We look at the terrible, terrible war in Ukraine. We see other situations in which we realize that the peace of Christ is the peace that prevails and the peace that we need. We also realize that in our own lives, there's a need for peace, interior peace, which so many difficulties and conflicts that we have, and also peace with others. And it's good on Palm Sunday to reflect upon whom we might be a better sign of peace for, especially someone in our families or with whom we work, or someone that we know who has hurt us, who has offended us, and we rightly feel anger, we rightly feel a grudge. To help us, like the Lord on the cross, as we just read in St. Luke's Gospel, "Father, forgive them, they do not know what they do." That forgiveness does not mean going in ways that would hurt us, but it does mean letting go of something that is not going to do us any good, a grudge which hurts us more than it hurts the other person. That palm is a wonderful sign of that peace that we bring to others within our lives. Also this week, as we move through Holy Week, it is good to reflect upon the Passion of the Lord. We call this Passion Week. And that Passion is given to us in the four Gospels. And each of the four Gospels recounts the Passion from Jesus' entry into Jerusalem until his death and burial. And each one of the four Gospels tells us the Passion in a different way, with different emphasis. Some of them emphasizing certain aspects of the facts, some of them doing it in a different way, each with a purpose to tell us the meaning of what Christ's Passion and death is all about in our lives. A good thing to do during Holy Week is to read the Passion from the four Gospels and to reflect upon how they are presented to us and what Jesus is saying to us. Because whenever we read the Scriptures, we are not reading something that happened 2,000 years ago. We are reading what Jesus says to us today, and his Passion speaks to us today. Today we read from the Gospel of St. Luke. And the reason is because this is the year, the liturgical year, in which the Gospel of St. Luke is listened to every Sunday. As we began the Mass, we read the account of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. What's interesting in that Gospel, though, Jesus enters as a king, as a prince of peace. And as the Gospel concludes, the next verse in the Gospel we don't read, but it's the verse when Jesus, seated upon the donkey, with those proclaiming his king, looks at the majesty of Jerusalem, the city of Jerusalem before us, and St. Luke tells us Jesus wept over Jerusalem. It's only two times in the Gospels we're told of Jesus weeping. One is here, the other is in the Gospel of St. John, where he weeps for the death of his friend Lazarus. Jesus weeps over Jerusalem as he is seated there, the Prince, the King of Peace. A few years ago, our Holy Father, reflecting on that passage from St. Luke's Gospel, says that God does weep for us. God does weep for us because we do not allow him to love us. How true that is. And as we look at why Jesus gave his life for us and for everyone, why Jesus came as a prince, not riding into Jerusalem as a king showing majesty and power, but as a prince of peace, and knowing that the cross was before him, he weeps for us because he loves us. And we many times, from the very beginning, do not allow him to love us. God wept in the Garden of Eden. God wept in the Garden of Eden because Adam and Eve would not allow him to love them. They had their own way. They had a better way. The love of God was not what they were looking for. They were looking for their own self-promotion. How we see that so much around the world today. How we see that in the terrible tragedy that is happening in the Ukraine. God weeps with those people who are suffering, who are giving their lives, who are treated in such a cruel way. But he weeps for the ones who caused that terrible massacre, because they will not allow the love of God to touch them. They have their own way, their own power, their own authority. They will not allow God's love to touch them, even to ask for forgiveness for what they're doing. They can't even begin to think about it because they hold on to that power, their own self-esteem, their own self-worth in their own eyes. Jesus weeps. Jesus weeps for Jerusalem. But he weeps because he loves us, and he wants us to let him love us so that we know what the meaning of life is all about. So interesting in the Gospel of St. Luke is that two more times of weeping are mentioned to us in the Passion we just read. The second is when Peter denies Jesus. Jesus told Peter, before the cock crows tonight three times, you're going to deny me. Peter says, that's never going to happen. And then when three people ask him, do you know Jesus? And Peter says, no, I don't even know who the man is. When the cock crows and he recognizes what he had done, we are told he went out and wept bitterly. Peter wept for the right reason, not for himself, but because he realized what he had done. And he allowed God to love him. He allowed God to love him. He didn't hold on to his sin. He didn't hold on to his pride, unlike Judas, who did and would not allow God to love him. He wept bitterly because he knew that it was Christ's love for him that made the difference. And as Jesus is walking with the cross, he encounters the women of Jerusalem who come up to him weeping. And Jesus' words to them is, do not weep for me. Weep for yourselves because of what is going to happen. Jesus never looked for any type of consolation in his passion. Jesus never complained about his suffering and his pain. As those nails were driven into his hands upon the cross, his words are, Father, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing. Jesus weeps because those closest to him, us, all of his people, many times will not allow him to love them. And they hold on to a position of God that is not who God is. As we celebrate this Passion Sunday, as we celebrate Holy Week, we look to the Lord as we are, and we say to the Lord, allow us to love you. May we let go of those things in our lives which we hold on to, we're afraid to be without, even though they're no good for us and no good for what we're all about. May we allow you to forgive us. Allow you to forgive us because we let go of them. And as our Holy Father tells us, God never gets tired of forgiving. And may we look to the Lord and, like Peter, weep at times, but always for the right reason. May God bless you again, and may Holy Week and Palm Sunday be filled with the blessings and the joy of God who has given himself to us. As we read in the second reading today from Philippians, who lowered himself to become one of us, in order that we could be raised with him to life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. And now, as a family of faith centered around the table of the Lord, we profess, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. With faith and confidence in God, our loving Father, who has given us his Son, who gave his life, we turn to him with our prayers and needs.
For the church on earth, may Jesus our Savior keep us faithful and lead us in the way of truth. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the salvation of the world, may God's love soften the hearts and minds of all people. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all preparing to enter the church, may the Holy Spirit fill them with the love of God. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for our family of faith, may God use our fasting, alms, and prayer for his glory and draw us closer to himself. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for all those being called to share in the Passion of Christ as priests, deacons, and a consecrated life, that they will echo his eternal word of mercy in their own faithfulness to the Father's will. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for all who have died in faith, especially during this Lenten season, may they rejoice with the angels and saints in heaven. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And we pray especially for the people of this parish for whom this Mass is being offered. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for all the intentions that we hold in the silence of our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Loving Father, as we now enter the hour of the Eucharist, the Last Supper, we join with our Lord in offering ourselves to you that through his body and blood we may know the fullness of his life within each of us. And we ask this in his name, who lives with you in the unity of the Spirit, God, forever and ever. Pray, my sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Father Almighty.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and of all his holy church.
Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by the sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels, we praise you as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Mortem tuum annunciamus Domine, et tuam resurrectionem confiteremur, Domine veni
us. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Gerald our Bishop, and all the clergy.
Remember also our brothers.
sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and with all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant our peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit, let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Peace with you, Father Brian. Peace with you, Albert. Thank you. Peace with you, John. Peace again. Thank you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace, Ashley. And this mingling of the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring each eternal life to us. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. the body of Christ in it. The body of Christ. 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 May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The body of Christ. The body of Christ.
Thank you.
Son and Holy Spirit. Amen. The body of Christ. The body of Christ. The body of Christ. The body of Christ. Let us pray. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son, you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection, you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
May Holy Week again be blessed for each and every one of you and your families, and through the saving action of our Lord, may we come to know his joy in our lives. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit. Bow your head for the blessing.
Look, we pray, O Lord, on this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ did not hesitate to be delivered into the hands of the wicked and submit to the agony of the cross, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Go forth.
Go forth. The Mass is ended.